Well, good evening, everyone. Welcome along to the Dundee Stars live show. Stephen Swan here with Omar Pasha, as always. And tonight's guest, well, one that is certainly the talk of the town when Elite League proceedings are on, Omar. We've got Ryan Finnerty on with us tonight. And, well, plenty to talk to about. I'm sure there's a host of referees watching this to see what and all sorts. So, yeah, a great show coming up. But how's your week been, Omar? How was the lecture on Monday when you were the one you had your slides prepared for? Did it go well?
Yeah, it went well. It's just weird teaching on a Zoom call there when you don't really know if they're actually paying attention or not. So I was always asking them questions to see who was listening or not. And seemed like it was only the same two or three that were answering. So I challenged them at the end of the class. But a lot of them are Chinese, so the English is not their first language. So, but I'm still wanting them to get involved and to say a few things. So it went all right. It went all right. Monday night, though, didn't the guys from the Hockey for All will want a few comments on that on Monday night. Yeah, my team got pumped, like absolutely destroyed. So Georgie was happy. Georgie, if you're watching, is happy. But so 1-1 playing there. I scored two goals, but it wasn't even close.
So of course you have to get in the bit there. You got beat, but you scored the two goals, Pash. No, how is the forward? Well, the forward thing's clearly not working for you that well. If you're getting pumped, as you describe it, you know.
No, I am not going back. But well, I don't go back check anyways. So it's fun playing forwards, but I don't know why a forward would play forward. It's way too much work. I just stay on D. Well, you can ask Ryan that. So why he played forward, but. As everybody would do, forwards will blame the D will blame the goalie. So I was just ready to blame my defense and my goalie. So
always pick on everyone else. Shocking.
How about you?
Yeah, good week this week. A lot of online stuff, actually. I feel like I've sat at this MacBook for 6 days in a row, you know, just a lot of things online and a lot of catch-ups with various people over the week as well. It's been cool.
Yeah, good. Ryan and I are following some Austrian hockey tonight, so we're keeping in touch. We always said to ourselves we'll follow some Austrian hockey, so I'm sure we'll talk about that tonight. But yeah, no, it's been a good week. I think a lot of things are going on in the background. I'm sure Ryan and I will talk about that with the league and what we're doing. And you know, for us, the Stars, we got new towels out, guys. So get your towels. Got new towel, Dundee Stars towels. The shop is going really well. So, Gold Club, you got another week before you join. So we're our raffle. So things are ticking along. I think we all kind of miss it, but we're all trying to keep busy. So, yeah, it's weird times, but you got a big game tonight, anyways, eh?
Yeah, definitely, it's a big game tonight. Dundee are playing their first game tonight as well. It's gonna be big exciting night, but hopefully they beat Hearts. Sorry to any Hearts fans who are watching, but yeah, I'm very excited for that. And we've got to talk about the prize story that you've got for the Gold Club. How on earth did you bag an awesome prize like that, which will be drawn on the 30th of October for all members who have signed up by then? How did you manage to get that, Omar?
Well, it wasn't me. I phoned Steve. I asked Steve if, because obviously he's involved heavily with the meetings and board meetings. And he said, he just told me, he's like, well, I asked him, I say, hey, do you think we can get two tickets for the Final Four weekend and we can raffle them off? He's like, yeah, sure. And then I called him again just to make sure. And he's like, yeah, we'll figure that out. So, I think that's going to be something we'll have to get after. But we were able to secure that prize, which was great. And there's other prizes that, you know, we've done in the past with the Weaver's Mill. And obviously, there's another project that we're working on in the background. So things are ticking on. We have our Legends team has been made. So that's exciting. So we'll get those jerseys out sooner rather than later as well. So there's a lot of things going on, and you know, we're all trying to keep trucking along, trying to stay busy as well. And and you know, with that prize on Friday, hopefully that person winning will have a great early Christmas present, I guess.
Yeah, Dev, I'm sure Ryan will be asking for certain or a similar prize for his team after tonight's show, bagging an awesome prize like that. So everyone sign up to the Gold Club if you can.
Ryan will invite them in their box. Ryan will bring them the full.
Yeah, Ryan will give you an extra prize. He'll bring you up into his box, buy you a champagne bottle. He's made of cash. I think Ryan will do that for us, won't he, Apash? What do you reckon?
Well, why don't you ask him? Let's bring him on then.
Go for it. Ryan Finnerty.
Hello.
Finner, how's it going?
I'm good. Hey, first of all, those Chinese kids are like, how the hell did we get a French-Canadian teaching us online? I can't understand a word this guy's saying. I thought he was going to be Scottish.
I always wonder that too when I was online and in class. They look at me. All you got to say is it's a sports class, right? So I always, when I feel I lose them, I say LeBron James. And then they all get excited and they all know who that is.
They spent the last 6 months learning Scottish, and here you are, they got a French Canadian teaching them. What course?
It's a weird one doing it online. I tell you what, because you're in front of the laptop, you don't see anybody. They put all their cameras out, so you're talking the window.
Just talking to symbols.
Yeah, and then we're asking them to be involved. It's the same two people that are talking, but no, this week now they have strict rules where they have to participate. But last year was fun. At least I had two players in the class. But it's a good experience, Finner. You gotta get involved in that too at university.
Yeah, I did it 2 years ago. I did it, and then I did a couple seminars. But I just get drowned. Like I did a couple at Salford Uni. I did a couple seminars, but they always invite like football and rugby legends.
Yeah.
And I get like the token petty questions like, well, this guy hasn't talked for 45 minutes. And then there's like a quick like divert back to like, yeah, the football or rugby or cricket. Yeah. But yeah, they are good though. I'll give you that. It's a fun experience for us anyways.
Yeah.
Ryan, who's been getting on with you? What have you been up to?
Oh, you know, staying busy. Not much. We finally bought a house out here, which has been nice. So I got my settlement visa after 12 and a half years. So that's nice. Worked my way into that. And then we bought a house and we moved out to the country. So kind of been doing that the last couple of weeks. And that's occupied my time. And then just being a dad and a husband talking to Pasha now and again and keeping an eye on what's going on. Obviously we've still kept our team on, our marketing guys. We've still kept them on and we're still working in the background like every other team, trying to stay afloat the best we can and relevant and communicating with our fans. And yeah, so it's kind of like probably the same as what's going on everywhere else. We're just looking around and all good coaches do, just stealing good ideas and make them their own. So yeah. I like what you guys are doing with the raffle about the box, which by the way is like the number one thing anybody's ever been in those boxes. They're awesome.
Yeah.
I've done it now 10 years. Unfortunately, I'm in the box more than I'm on the bench, but like you get that experience. My brother-in-law, he travels all over the world for business. And he's like the number one event I've ever gone to is a Final Four in Nottingham. And he's been everywhere. And people are like, what are you talking about? He's like, EIHL, Final Four, you got to go. He's better than Super Bowl, he said.
It's a great experience. But we're not giving tickets on the box, though, Ryan. We're just getting them in the grandstand. So I don't want anybody
Hey, in the storm, we bring in, we feed them everything.
I know. So, Ryan, speaking about hockey and whatnot, for yourself, we had this chat about a few weeks back. This must be your first year in forever, right? Where you're actually not coaching or playing in a winter time, eh?
Yeah, I mean, when I think I started playing, I was four or five, three or four, I don't even know. I mean, yeah, and from then, really, if you think about it, we never missed a winter playing. Yeah. I'm going to the rink every weekend, and then right in from playing to coaching, and yeah. And you know what? At the start, the downtime was nice, but now it's like,
what to do on weekend? That's
the problem. It's getting a little darker now, and the clocks are going back soon. It's going to be tough. I, Yeah, I don't know why there's not 50,000 people in our stands, because it's a pretty entertaining night out. I would give anything now to go to an ice rink, hang out with my buddies, have a few pops, watch some hockey.
Yeah.
I'd give anything right now to go do that as a fan, let alone as a coach. But yeah, crazy, crazy, crazy. I mean, we talk about it all the time. Like, you just kind of, the weekends come and then the weekends go, and then you're back into Monday, and it's like the dog days just continue and continue and continue.
Yeah.
Oh, that's thanks. Awesome.
Thanks for the update, Gordon. We appreciate that. You need to put the other games that Finner is following as well, Wayne. But for you, Finner, when we talk about this downtime, how obviously we found out from the league right at that point in time, there's no season. What was your perception throughout the summer? I mean, I was vocal about mine, but what was yours pretty much from the end of the season to I guess now?
I was super optimistic. Yeah. Like my optimism kind of went like this and then went like that, you know. And I think we spoke a lot, and we were pretty much on the same page. Yeah. Even there was that time where there was that cross period where, like, I still want to remain optimistic. And then now we look back and we're like, holy, were we off the mark, you know, thinking maybe we'd be getting going right now. But I'm always an optimistic guy, man. I've always been that way. I'm not really a negative. I've always been overly optimistic, I think. Looking back now, I mean, to where we are, it's crazy to think that we were even optimistic at all. we're like in Manchester now. We're in like tier 2.5 lockdown, because the government's put us in lockdown, and then Andy Burnham, our mayor, has put us back into, like, I don't even know. I have no idea what's going on right now.
Yes.
You can't go out after a certain time.
I don't know. I honestly, Pash, I have no idea what is happening. I know that we moved into tier three, but then they've said, no, we're not in tier three. I mean, our arena's open and shut in the same day, like, three times. Like, it's been absolutely chaos in Trafford, in Manchester here. Like, we've been in tier two since freaking March, August, I guess. But yeah, so I don't even know where we're at right now. At some point, you just don't even care anymore. It's just, get on with this.
It's crazy. Go ahead, Swanee.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, Ryan, and you, Pash, as well. Did you guys approach the, I know you were optimistic about the season kind of going ahead or not going ahead, but was there a slightly different approach from both of you, considering you have you're in the smaller budget teams to the big guys?
Yeah, I think probably Pash and I understand our situation better than anyone. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think we're pretty much on par with across the board with our spending power and what we're able to do. We can obviously work it around school budgets and whatever the best we can. But yeah, I mean, it's catastrophic to think about going through it all the way to August and trying to. Yeah, I don't think it's the idea of, like, how we're going to get through. I think we'll always find a way to get through. But what we're left with, with what we get to start with, is, like, you know, when the real money starts, you know, I think we're going to try to continue to find a way to stay relevant and stay above water. But at the end of the day, when you lose that much money, there's no carryover, you know. It's either reinvest or we try to make it work the best we can. And that's a tough predicament to be in, and one that I don't think we should be in. Like, I think the government needs to step in. It needs to bail out the number one indoor sport, you know, attended indoor sport in the country.
Yeah.
Just as they have in lower-end football, just as they have in basketball, just as they have across the board. You know, we're a huge, huge fish in that pot of money. And yeah. I think I was on the BBC, or I was on Radio Manchester yesterday, saying the same thing. Like, you know, just because we're not everybody's flavor, we're a massive, massive sport in this country. In comparison, when you get outside of your top mainstream sports, we're massive. We're huge. Mm-hmm. And Dundee and Manchester are part of it just as much as Sheffield and Nottingham are.
Yeah. 100%. I think you nailed it on the head there, Finner. I mean, as both clubs, I mean, you're always trying to fight through these times and to stay relevant, which I'm sure both clubs have stayed relevant throughout this time. But going back to what just Finner just said there, the perception of everybody now, I think across, as a hockey fan, you know this, how big this sport is in the UK and how popular it is. But it was good. It is now good to see, you know, attention. I think it was a government or somebody, an MP from a few weeks ago from Nottingham, step up and communicate. And also the work the league is doing behind the scenes. And it's coming to a point where, you know, it's almost like a no-brainer. Like we are, and it's not to brag or anything, but we are the number one indoor professional sport in all the UK. And I think there is a big market for that. And for us as a league to be involved in that, whether you're in Manchester, Dundee, or Sheffield, or Cardiff, or Belfast, we're all a part of this together. And I think he's right. He almost, now you think like everybody has to step in and to give us a bit of support. So hopefully that will happen and that will help the hockey in the future. Because I really think, like speaking to a few people around here, obviously, there is a market for other than football, and everybody knows and nobody's disputing. We're not competing with football. Football's on another level. But you look at North America, you look at other, I guess, Europe countries, there is secondary or third sports. And I think as a league, we have to really envision to be that second sport, whether it be with us and rugby hand in hand or them ahead of us, whatever. But we can be in that same conversation moving forward. And hopefully that will kickstart with the attention and kickstart with the government to hopefully give us some aid in these times.
Well, we had MP the other week, of course, that got a lot of attention from hockey fans. Ryan, I know you've been on BBC Radio all the time saying this, more should be done from the government. Other sports have received things and we've got the attention. Do you think enough has been done, Ryan, by the Elite League and those involved in it to actually make it known that the sport's as big as it is? Because it is very easy, if you're not a hockey fan, not to know about the fact that there's thousands of people watching this every week.
Yeah, I mean, I think the guys working for the league are doing the best they can. You know, I think it, with the current setup that we have, I don't think you ever feel like you're doing enough. I don't think as Manchester, we feel like we've done enough or doing enough to get our name out there. And I think everybody from, you know, the top to the bottom would feel the same. And I think the league is the same way. I think there's always opportunities to promote more, but I'm not going to lay it at anybody's door, you know, because the way the league is structured, there's a lot of guys doing volunteer jobs to make sure that the league is running the way they are. And they got businesses, they got their own livelihood too, as well. So it's a tough structure. But at the same time, I think the league in itself have done enough where we should probably get a little more recognition from mainstream media. You know, and I think even if you want to hitch onto what the GB team have done, I think ice hockey alone should have been on a little bit of, you know, should have been put on some steroids here with the mainstream media over the last 3-4 years, you know, for what the league has accomplished and where we've gone. And I think maybe we have, like Pash and I, may have more insight because we can compare to like the Norways and Denmarks and all those places that 10 years ago were seen as a way better destination. Or now, I would argue, I think Denmark hockey is shit. I think Norway has two or three good teams, the rest are shit. Yeah. I think our level and our standard, if you play a 7-game series the way we play, we're in a top echelon, you know. Mm-hmm. We're moving out of that double A top. We're at the top of the double A pile, touching the trail. And we've proved it in the Champions League, you know. Yeah. But we don't get the respect out of Scandinavia. Like, my wife's Swedish, so I have this argument all the time. And Swedes play a certain way, and Swedes are a certain way. Swedes love Swedes, and they love the way Swedish plays hockey. They don't like the North American style, and we're considered North American. So when you're a North American style in Europe, you're not going to get that level of respect that we deserve. But at the end of the day, I mean, I think, you know, you look at what teams have done in the Champions League from here, you know, and these are teams that we shouldn't even be touching that we're beating, you know. And so I don't really like the comparison to the Bundesliga or the Danish league or Norwegian league, because I just genuinely think we're much better. We're much better run. And I genuinely think we have way, and this is outside of myself, I think we have way better coaches in this league, which is, I think, is the most nobody ever talks about. But I think from when I started, which was like in 1964, I think, when I first came over to here, the coaching is incredible now. There's no bad coaches. Mm-hmm. Like, there's no bad coaches. There used to be shitty coaches, and it was awesome if you thought you were a good coach. But there's no bad coaches. There just isn't anymore.
Yeah.
We used to have first-year coaches, you know. There's just the coaching at this level is so good. And obviously, it's the number one thing that gets targeted every weekend. You know, 5 out of 10 teams, that coach needs to get fired. And that's the beauty of Britain. But the reality is that every coach in this league can move into any other league and have success. And it's been done. I mean, you've seen it when guys do leave. And we'll continue to see it with guys leaving and going out after other jobs.
I think, Fenner, we had this discussion one time, and, you know, we were talking, I think it was a few years back, and we just, you know, we at one point, you know, in other clubs and other leagues in the world, there's a lot of assistant this, assistant that, assistant general manager, there would be a director of hockey. There would, like in our league, I would say a lot of the coaches have, you know, 95 to 100% more job than any other coach in any league. And
dude, we're like single mothers here with 5 kids. We're just doing everything, you know.
Single mothers with 5 kids, but we have full of energy though, Finner. We're always energized.
Except we got more energy.
And then we want to be both GMs of running the club too on the business side. So even
what a great idea that was, right?
We adopt another 3 kids with that one. So
No, it's true, man. And I mean, I'm not talking about myself or being ignorant or arrogant. I take myself out of it and I look at the other 9 coaches, and they're good coaches. Like, they're just it is very difficult to out-coach somebody in this league. Mm-hmm. It is, because everybody's detailed, everybody's switched on, everybody knows. You know, if I go to Dundee, I know Bastion already knows what breakout I'm running, and I got to switch it. At the 18-minute mark of the first, I'm like, oh, shit. All right, let's go with it. You know what I mean? And 4 or 5 years ago, you ran your same play all the time, and everybody did whatever they did. Nobody adjusted. Now you're dealing with constant adjustments. You're dealing with video nerds all day long. You know, these coaches now, like in this league, are very good. They're very, very good. They're very structured. And the problem is that maybe they stay too long in this league because – they, you know, we don't actually know how good they are until they leave. And as you've seen, you see guys leave and do, you know, Rob Wilson back in the day, all the way up to the DEL from, you know, like everybody who's left this league has done extremely well, because they are, like you said, they take over everything. They're not good at one aspect of the game. They're not a power play special teams. They know from the goal line to the goal line, they know the game in and out. And that's rare, I think.
But I think a great opportunity. You know, obviously you've been in the league for a while. I've been in the league for a while, and you kind of learn different aspects that you probably wouldn't have ever been able to learn at a normal coaching job. Like right now, your baggage of experience, Finner, from, you know, from your time here, from your experience you've coached against other coaches, or your experience also off the ice too. I mean, that's maybe the experience you've gained now in this league could have probably never have ever happened. And you were a player coach too before too. As well.
I did it 1 year in Sheffield. Yeah, it's not the fun. Yeah, you did it too. You did it for a few years. I hated every second I was a player coach. From the moment I got the job to the moment I gave up the job and just became, I hated every second of it.
Why is that, you think?
Well, I think because I'm not that kind of guy. Like, I was the kind of guy to just put myself on the third or fourth line or whatever we had and be that centerman and then just push everybody else up, because I'm just not that guy to be the guy or put myself, you know what I mean? It's a very difficult job, I find. You know, if I had to be a player coach, I'd be a freaking goalie. Because my job, I just save the puck or I don't save the puck. Like, the rest of you guys, I can chirp you all day long. But it's
Would you
really
hurt yourself, Finner? Would you hurt yourself if you were a goalie?
Oh yeah, in the first 7 minutes in.
1-2 on 1, and then you're done for the game. Eh?
I'm done. I'm like a football goalie. I'm yelling and screaming at my players, and I'm gone. Gate duty.
When you accepted that job, Finner, at Sheffield, you know, obviously now looking back, you're a coach now, you're a general manager as well. But looking back at that time, it was the right move because it was an opportunity for you to get
home. It was weird. I think it was the first year that Tony took over the team. Mm-hmm. He had to pay the team out basically with the season ticket money. So there wasn't it wasn't the Sheffield we see today. But we recruited a good, I think we only lost like 9 games all year. Like we finished second to Belfast, I think. We lost to Belfast in Belfast the second last week of the season, and we were mathematically in second by a mile. Yeah. So the last weekend meant nothing, but yeah. And it was good. It was a good experience, you know, but that playing coach is tough, man. Especially as a rookie coach, and you're only, you know, 29 or whatever I was, like it's a lot in Sheffield, you know. It was a lot on your plate, but at the same time, it was a good learning experience. Get through, and then and then I think in Glasgow is when I really kind of, I actually think in Glasgow is probably where I really saw a future in coaching. Like where I'm like, hey, you know, when you get like I had a 2-year deal in Sheffield, didn't get re-signed. Signed with Blackie in Glasgow. And I think kind of when you don't get re-signed, you get a little like F you in your game, you know, like, okay. And then you come back stronger. You spend the whole summer getting better, you know, or like as a player, you spend the whole summer working out harder, getting in better shape. You come back after that year. It's kind of the same as coaches. When you get fired, then you come back stronger. You want to come back stronger. It was a different, you know, intellectually. And then it was good for me because when I went to Glasgow, I didn't coach anybody that were my buddies. I didn't have to coach my buddies. I didn't have to coach my line mates, you ever watch The Office, The U.S. Office?
Yeah, I watch a bit.
I'm a big Office guy, so I always like, there's none of that. You know, like, you can actually bring in your own guys, and they only know you as a coach, not you as a buddy, like a good buddy that we played together for 4 years or 3 years, you know? So that was nice, and then just able to kind of establish, you know, my own thing. I brought Kevin Bergen in as my player assistant. Do you know Bergen?
Yeah, I know of it. Well, I met him a few times. Yeah, he's you love your French Canadians.
So. I do. Yeah, I hate my French Canadians, but I love him too. So I brought Bergen in too, and he was awesome. You know, he was there for 1 year, and then he wants to get into coaching, which he is now with Bruce Richardson in the queue. It was fun, and I think that's when my love, like my passion for like wanting to get in on the hockey business side and the general manager side started, because when Bergie and I showed up in Glasgow, there wasn't one employee there. Well, there was, but like Kirsty Longmuir had kind of like, she'd already handed her notice in, and we basically showed up in a city we've never been in, and we're like just handed the keys, like good luck, and we had to do everything. And I think that's where we kind of, and Blackie he just said, get on with it. Like, don't call me until it's done, and find the housing, find this, do that. And then Gareth came in maybe a couple months later, you know, like maybe September-ish, I can't remember, maybe October. I'm not sure when Gareth came in, but yeah. And then Gareth kind of took on like a lot of the role from us, but So I think that's when our passion for that, you know, and navigating through a city we've never been in, trying to like find contacts and do everything and recruit teams. And it was cool. It was, looking back, it was a really, really good experience.
And when you went to Glasgow, obviously that franchise was turned around at that point. Well, as a coach, when you look back, because there was that year where you guys almost won, right? That 1 year where I think you guys lost the last game or something like that, where you guys were 1 or 2 points away from the championship.
That's what I was going to say on my grave. I almost won it twice.
But that, well, let's say that year, like, does that, as a coach, was that also a factor in your mind and think, all right, I'm actually good at this, and you built confidence to want to do this for your career?
Well, my first year there, we did really well. I think at Christmas we were like in first or second.
Yeah.
And then I think we ended up slipping back to fourth or something like that. But we made the playoff final weekend, which, you know, like, as you know, is everything. Winning two games at the end of the year trumps the 54. But and then the second year we came back, and yeah, we added some really, like, really good pieces, you know. And that was a year, but that was a year too. Like, it was a great year, but there was conferencing as well. Mm-hmm. You know, and Dundee, you were in Hull, I think, right?
Yeah, yeah,
you beat us in playoffs. You guys knocked us out in playoffs.
Was that your second year in Glasgow?
That was my second year. That was, you guys knocked us out in playoffs.
Yeah.
That was just a fun year. It's like you just get that group that just works. It just mixes, and we had toughness, we had scoring, we had a bit of everything, and it clicked. That's when I think the business really grew too. But it also, like, the Rangers were like in the 15th league of Scottish football. Like, they were having a ton of problems as well. So I think it just kind of, like, everything just kind of matched up. We were doing really good. There was a lot of negativity in Scottish football on the Rangers side, and a lot of them just came across, checked out a game, had a few pops, and enjoyed it. And then our crowd just kind of went boom.
Because, like, you were selling out in Glasgow. They were selling out, 10-15 games in a row, something crazy.
Yeah, it was crazy, man. Like, during like, kind of like, I want to say, like, early December onwards, it was rammed. And it didn't matter if we were playing Edinburgh, Cardiff, Dundee, you know. It didn't matter. It didn't matter who we were playing. We were just rammed. And then I think, like anything, that set the expectation maybe unrealistically high. You know, like, you can have a good year, but it's really hard to follow up. But even the next year, you know, we went to the Champions League the next year. And, you know, we did as well as could be expected in that. We were flying. We had guys flying into London on the way to the game to play the Swedish champions. We were picking, like, we pretty much needed name tags just to make sure everybody was on the bus that belonged. You know, like, guys were flying in and meeting us in London from Calgary. They hadn't skated with the team. Like, hey guys, I'm so and so. Oh great, yeah, come on in. We're heading to Bekwa. And we were up like 2-1 on them too. I was hoping there was going to be like a malfunction and the ice plant was going to go down. We'll just call it. But yeah, no, that was cool. That was fun. We had a great team that year. You know, some changes that I unfortunately didn't really want to see happen. I still am pissed off about that. But yeah, no. And then the next year was just a down year, just a rebuild down year. Things didn't click, and then we ended up. And then we were in Manchester.
And for you, when you did that Champions League, how was that experience overall with you know, what you knew as a coach and what you've experienced just so far looking back now?
It was good. Like we went to Sweden, and like Vekwa just won the Champions League. My wife is like from that town.
Yeah.
So like, well, just outside, and they were flying. They'd been skating for 2.5 months, like as a team, like 2.5 solid months, you know, and they were so good that night. It's crazy though, because it was like watching a NASCAR race. You know, like, it was just like players were just flying, and you're like, holy crap! What? And we got pumped. I think it was like 10-2. I think it's 7-2. I was like, I'm okay with this score. 8-2, and then I remember thinking, like, just not 10, not 10, not 10. And they put out like a 16-year-old kid who's probably if I look back, he's probably a first rounder now. And he toe dragged at the blue line as a defenseman around Alex Levitt, toe dragged through his legs and went shelf. And I was like, that just happened. That, like, with like 42 seconds left. He had a cage on. I haven't seen him all game. And he was just a stud. But then they came back to us, and we almost beat them. We almost beat them in Glasgow like a month later. I think they beat us 3-1. It was we were in that game all day long.
Yeah.
You know, all the, like, we had breakaways that we rang the post. We you know, wraparounds that went across, like post posts and out. And yeah, and then we beat Ingolstadt mm-hmm. as well. Yeah. It was good. And we should have beat Ingolstadt in their building. We had them. Like, I felt like we were the better team. In fact, I actually, so they interview after, right, which is just bullshit because it's like two German reporters and you do the whole press conference. They make it look good, but it's really like, and I was so mad that we lost. I think we lost like 3-2 or 4-2 in Ingolstadt. But and I'm like, oh, they're like, ask you, and both coaches are there. And I'm not like cocky after games, or I'm not, you know what I mean? I don't get like, usually like now I can deal with losses and be like, well, you know.
But you weren't very good at that, eh, early in your career?
Yeah, I was. But then I'm like, oh, we'll 100% beat these guys in Glasgow. We shouldn't have lost tonight. And that's all I said. And then I walked out. I'm like, did I just say that? Like, did I just say that? And they came to Glasgow and they had to beat us to move on, and we beat them.
Wow.
It was good, yeah. But I said it. I'm like,
I played in his mind, though, eh? You got in his head.
I think he coaches the Oilers now. Or I think he's like on like the guy they fired him. I think they fired him after. I think they fired him before he left Glasgow. And I think he's actually coaching the Oilers now. He's like one of the assistants in the NHL. Yeah.
And how was the logistics with that? Like the travel, was that a challenge, especially when you have a new team like Glasgow at the time?
No, Blackie was pretty good. I think we flew into Copenhagen, which is what you would do anyways. Jumped on a bus and a couple hours down into Vekwa, and then back into Kopi, and then over to Germany. Oh. Yeah, no, it was good. And so we played, I want to say like we played like a Thursday, Sunday kind of thing.
Yeah.
If I remember correctly. It was smooth. Yeah. No, Blackie, like he did a good job. I mean, no complaints, you know. Yeah. Stayed in a hotel, had some pregame skates and day before skates there. So yeah, no, it was good. We stayed right next to the rink both times, I think. So yeah, no, it was pretty smooth. I mean, we didn't have any hellish travel, you know. We went Sweden to Germany, so it wasn't too bad.
So it's cool. So Finner, I gotta ask you, obviously you had, before we go to Manchester now, you have your career in Glasgow, right? And you play Dundee as a rival team. Few incidents happen in Dundee, one that will come upon because our fans will love to hear the reasoning behind this. But what was your experience? Because you always have some good moments here in Dundee. What was your experience of coaching in Dundee and sometimes with whether it be the referees or the fans?
Well, it's funny because I was in Glasgow for so long. So, and you see the same refs. So you kind of know them as a Glasgow player. So then I always had that, like, now I'm in England. So I always, like, day one, and like if we have Toby Craig, I'll be like, Toby, all Ranger guys here, all Ranger fans. Everyone, we were up all night watching the Ranger. You know, like, we always kind of have that banter. You know what? Yeah. In fairness, you always like, oh, freaking Scottish refs. But I'm different because I've had that on both sides. I get it. Like, you know, like, it is what it is. It's just, you know. You always say, oh, we don't think we'll get many power plays there.
What did you say after the game one time? He says, I couldn't believe it. We had a power play in the first period.
We don't practice any power play in Scotland. Just 5-on-4. 5-on-4.
So, Swan, you want to ask him about the glove now that he's on?
We have to ask you about this, Ryan. All the fans have always talked about this. Your moment when Dundee played you in that game in Glasgow to secure themselves to the Nottingham finals.
Oh, the glove. Yeah, we called the illegal glove.
What's known as the Finnerty glove incident. Could you talk us through your process, thought on that? Because Mark was furious at you.
Yeah. the Chevrier, right?
No, it was Fallon at the time.
Fallon. Oh, okay. So They'd beaten us 3-1 or something like that in Dundee, and then we were down 2 goals. And my equipment guy had said, he said, hey, his glove is illegal. And I said, I didn't even know that existed. I'm like, what are you, I'm like, illegal? Like, what do you mean? He's like, yeah, you can't, it has to be a certain whatever, right? And I'm like, desperate times call for desperate measures. And I remember asking, I'm like, are you, I'm like, I remember like, can you even call that? Is it like, and then they looked like, yeah, you can, you can. I'm like, all right, well. And then I think we went down even another goal and I'm like, oh, what do I have to lose? And we called it, you know, as kind of a chicken shit move. But again, you do whatever is best for your club, right? If I mean, if we score on that power play and Dundee's pissed off, maybe it turns, maybe it doesn't. But in my head, why wouldn't you do it? But at the same time, I have no idea. That's what equipment guys are for. That's why good equipment guys. And he was right. The glove was illegal. I don't know. I think he ended up grabbing the backups in. But yeah. But I remember Corey called an illegal curve on my goalie when we beat him out of nine. And I remember thinking like, oh, what a, and I'm good friends with Corey. I'm like, you, what a coward. Are you kidding me? Yeah. And then here I am calling a glove 4 years later. Well, yeah, that's what it was. It was just like, all right, well, we'll save it in the back. And then all of a sudden it was like, oh, bring it out. We're going to need that ammo now. Hopefully we won't need it. I think before the game, I'm like, well, hopefully we don't have to go there. And then we were just getting pumped. And I'm like, huh, all right, let's do it. But yeah. So yeah, I didn't know what
happened. I had nothing to lose.
Huh?
I said for the fans that are wondering, you had nothing to lose and you
didn't. Nothing to lose.
Exactly.
And for you guys, it worked out in your benefit. I think it actually flipped. It didn't work for me.
Yeah.
It didn't work for us. I would still do the same thing. Innsbruck 3, Salzburg 1.
Oh. would you do it again today?
I hope I'm not in that situation. I don't know if I would do it again today. I don't even know if you could do it again today. Like, I don't think the way it is now, I don't think a goalie would get to the playoffs using that glove. It would have been called already, you know?
Yeah, that's a good point, too. If that glove was legal throughout the year, I think the refs did a poor job of identifying that the last game of the season, too.
Yeah, like, he had the same glove all year, I think. Yeah. I don't know, but yeah. I think it was the horse that the horse, you know, the horse in he's in Fife now. And I mean, there's a guy in Scotland that knows everything about equipment. It's Ian Kelly, the horse. And he was the one, I think, who called it. He said, I'm 100% sure. I'm telling you right now. And then he brought out his rule and I'm like, okay.
There you go, Swanee. The story for all the fans that were wondering.
Yeah.
Sorry, fans.
What did Mark say to you after it, Ryan? What was his response to you about that?
Well, he beat us out, so he was okay with it. I think. I think it would have been a turning point. He might have been a little more upset. and you know what? I forgot all about that. Honestly, hand on heart, haven't thought about that incident until you just brought it up. When you brought it up, I'm like, I have no idea what you're talking about. Like, it's
wow.
That's how much shady shit I do know.
Well, Dundee fans have never forgotten it, Ryan. I don't think they ever will, to be honest. Well, what is your looking at Glasgow as an overall? Ryan, as an overall picture, what was your proudest moment in your time at Glasgow then?
I think just being part of the development. I mean, being part of like the how we brought that organization from. I guess from where I walked in to where I left, I'm pretty proud of what we did with that organization. And it wasn't me. It was just being a part. I was just able to be a part of that time, you know, and able to be a part of that growth and watch that organization and be a part of it, you know, all the way to the Champions League, which I, you know, looking back now, how far that is for us to get to and how difficult that is. And, you know, I think we had to finish second to get there that year. And we did it on the last.
Are we losing? Oh, sorry, Finner. We lost you for a bit.
His internet's playing up, isn't it?
He's in the woods. He changed his, he moved aside for half a second.
Yeah, he's got like one bar of signal for internet, isn't he, where he is? Well, hopefully he comes back. He's not as bad as Gabby Levesque, right?
Is it my internet?
Yeah. Well, Finner, you talked about your internet for 5 minutes there at the start, so we're going to blame your internet for that one. Is it better now?
Are we back? Yeah. I had to wait 10 days for this internet.
Who'd you go with, BT or Sky?
No, I had to go with Vodafone out here because they were the only one who had a network out where we, I'm telling you, man, we're in the middle of nowhere. Not a light in sight. Just horses.
So yeah, you were saying about like Glasgow, how, you know, where you guys ended up to where you were at the start.
Yeah, I think, I think that was probably the most proud moment. And then like so many good guys we brought in, guys that I still talk to weekly, you know, that I coached 7-8 years ago. And
he's totally gone this time.
You know? What happened there? He's probably taking the Australian scores.
Yeah, hopefully so. Dundee's one minute into that game, Pash.
Going back to – oh, there he is. Okay, got you now.
We're good. Yeah. I hope. We're good?
Yeah.
We're good.
Yeah.
Okay. Are we live or are you hitting the edit button?
No, we're live. Everything that screws up is live.
But, yeah, no, and then you know what? And like when I went back for Matt Haywood's testimonial – it was kind of a proud moment because it was all the guys that I brought through, pretty much like the majority were like the guys that I brought through, which meant a lot, right? Because obviously, like for him, he's been a part of it all, and he brought back those guys from that era, which is kind of cool to see. You know, all these guys that you recruited, you brought in, which kind of is a self pat on the back that you brought in a good group of guys that still stay in contact and still teammates, you know, 6, 7, 8 years later. So that was a pretty cool feeling.
For me, Finner, just on your Glasgow days, I mean, one of my proudest moments as a coach was obviously beating you guys at the Final Four, at the playoffs. But saying all that, I mean, that Glasgow team, I think you guys were just surprised everybody in the league. And you were just so hard to play against, so tough to play against every year in Glasgow. And it was almost a building where you really – I mean, when you say buildings that are tough to play against, Glasgow is definitely one of them where, you know, the guys would be such a challenge from when my time in Hull as a player to my time in Manchester as a player. When you would go to Brayhead, you always expected them to be so hard to play against. And that's, I think, Finner, that the style of play you have, the way the guys play hard, it's always such a challenge, even in Manchester right now to this day. I've never won in Manchester since you've been there. And it's just the way you coach them and in Glasgow, you can tell the progression from that first year you took it over to where it was at the end. Like Glasgow now, maybe to Finner's extent, he brought that to a club that's expecting, you know, it's expecting every year. And you saw when they didn't make the playoffs, it was almost like, you know, catastrophe, you know, it was like not expected. Yeah. when you left. And that's the one thing about Glasgow, I think what you brought there. And obviously Pete had a great year after this year was, you know, they were fighting for a playoff spot, but I think that what you brought, that the culture there has certainly been something that established a lot. The one thing I'll say, Finner, though, my first impressions of you, and I never really talked, well, I think I talked to you about it, was when we were playing you guys in the playoffs and you called Lozon an effing diver and right in front of me. And it was like on the way. So we're walking through and bear in mind, Finner, I didn't really know Finner at the time. And you could always tell Finner, like, he's intimidating, like, as a player, because you would know him as a player because he had a reputation in the league as being a tough, like, you know, like a Bruce Richard, them both clash. I mean, how many times, like a tough player and tough to play against and whatnot. So I guess as a coach, we always looked at him as like, he's crazy. Like, you know, even when I was first year coach, he's crazy. And I remember we're walking in the hallway, and this is in the playoffs, and he starts shouting, I'm not gonna say the words, but stop diving, stop driving, a bunch of pasha, tell your guys to stop diving. And he goes on and on, and I'm like turning around and half saying F you because Jeff Smith's behind him too. So like, I'm like,
what a guy
before they beat us up. But No, that was the only time where in Brad, I felt like in that hallway. I think everybody gets, you know, when you walk by each other.
Yeah, it's a shitty hallway to kind of go through because there's too much crossing.
You have to tell me over under 10 times you had screaming matches with players or coaches from the other team.
Not that much. No, honestly, not here and there. But not over the, but you know what? Like for me, it's like, I could have that and then I'll get on the bus and I'll like, and then I'll text next, an hour later, be like, hey man, sorry, fart. Like, and I think that like, that's been my biggest bit, like, because mm-hmm. I've been around for so long, like the fans think I'm this like raging lunatic psycho yelling. And then you're like, well, it's not actually not, I'm pretty laid back actually. You know, like in my life, like my day to day, I'm a pretty laid back dude. Like, but yeah, but then you get intense. I mean, that's why you do what you do, because you have passion, you get fired up. And sometimes it's fake. Sometimes I do it because my players play better when I'm pissed off behind the bench. So it's fake, you know. And sometimes, yeah, I mean, with the refs in this league, there's not a pill in the world that can calm you down for what you see sometimes. They haven't invented the drug for Corona, and they haven't invented the drug for keeping your cool with some of these calls or decisions. But I think, I don't know, just over time, like you get fired up. You want to win so bad every game, whether it's Wednesday on October 16th or, you know, the end of March. You have the same passion to win.
You're right, though. Anytime I see after the game or, you know, I think I get that way too during the game, and you speak to him or, you know, I'm sure you've had that experience where you're mad at the game situation, but after the game, it's not like you're going to go out and actually go run a referee or run a player on the other team. Yeah. I think it's all the passion. And I think I get that probably a bit more. And I think we all get that as coaches, because it goes back to a bit what Finner says too. It's so competitive coaching, and it's so competitive the league, and every point matters, that, you know, if you feel like there is something that, whether it be a referee decision, whether it be, you know, whether it's a bad call or a cheap shot from the, you know what, you feel there's a lot of pressure going to that moment. And I feel a lot of coaches feel that as well at times.
Yeah, it's tons of pressure. I mean, even, and then you kind of remind yourself that like you get a bad call against you. I mean, I'm just thinking now about was it Marquardt that scored against Skinner? And then it was disallowed, face off, we scored, game over. Might be the only game I've won in Dundee over the last 3 years. Do you remember that? You were going nuts, but I, because you guys don't have the replay or anything, so even we couldn't see it. But Ginner came to the bench and he's like, oh yeah, bar and out, in 100% in. Like he was like, and I'm like, oh geez, okay. And I, because when it, you remember, it happened so fast, but that would, I think you guys would have tied it, or you would have went up by one, or
no, I think we would have went up by one. And the problem I had was like, everybody stopped, like Mag scores. So he's celebrating in the corner.
Yeah.
Which was, you can't really fault him, because you're like, well, I scored a goal and he was he was right there. He saw it. But I think looking back now, the other players are like, they were half going, half not. And then like Mag celebrating, which is, you know, I would have done the same thing as what Mag's done. So then they play on. And then I think was it Kieran Long and somebody else went on.
He scored.
And he scored. And then
And then the review went, and then it came no goal, and then we scored right off the faceoff.
Yeah.
And that was like game over. But Ginner came to the bench, and I'm like, of course, we're like, nobody really knows, right? Players are like, I don't know. And Ginner's looking at me, he's like, oh yeah. That was it. Like goalies know. Every goalie knows when he gets scored on. And he was like, oh yeah, back bar and out. And then it got no goal, and I was like, what?
So it was no goal for you, and then no goal for us, then goal for you. And then I was losing my shit too, because I'm like, well, why didn't you effing whistle there? And he's like, well, they didn't score. And I'm like, yeah, we scored. Yeah, but I didn't know you scored. And then you're like, you're third.
Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah,
And then they scored on the faceoff, which is our fault. So it didn't really help that. It
mattered. Yeah, it was just like bang, bang, bang. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you get that. Hearts are up 1-0, by the way, in Dundee.
Yeah.
Hearts are up 1-0.
Yeah. First guy.
I think the thing for our league is that those mistakes, because listen, as much as I got screwed in that, you got screwed before many times. Coaches
usually equal.
They equal out at the end. It's one thing though for the league, it's important that we get those decisions right going in the future. I mean, all our Stars fans will remember we went to Cardiff. There was a three goal spin or whatever you want to call it, switch where, you know, they had got advantage of three goals against us. When you look back on replay, it's pretty evident. So I think that's one thing from the league, you know, on a sporting side, we have to make sure those things go away, because you don't want to lose out, you know, in a game in Cardiff, for example. If you score a goal, I don't want to lose out, that's for sure. And then, you know, it wants to be at least as accurate as can be for goals. I think that's the main thing on my aspect is goals in this league. And, you know, we've got goals that this year I think we shouldn't have had. And we had goals that we were counted that, you know, we should have, that didn't count. We should have had, you know, and I'm sure it's the same for you, but every coach will have that. So it's a revolving circle going back and forth, back and forth.
Yeah. I think it probably all balances out at the end. Right? You know, try to remind yourself that, but they're never, I mean, they don't get it right in the Premier League. You know, they still make mistakes. So you can't really expect them to in our league with the limited technology we have, but it's definitely, I mean, you know what, it's like anything. You get on the bus and you drive, 7-8 hours to Dundee, and then in the last 2 minutes you lose a game. It's like, you know, players get undressed, get back up, get fed, and get on the bus and go home. Coaches just carry it the whole way home, analyzing. And yeah, and you're like, ah.
I think that was the worst when I was coaching, at least in Manchester and Hull. It was losing in Scotland because it's such a long way. But us, when we go to Guildford or Cardiff, it's 6 hours, but then Guildford and Cardiff is 10 or 11. It's always the funnest ones when we win, that's for sure. But those are definitely the hardest ones, the long trips. If anybody thinks that coaches take it easy on the way back, I tell you what, those are the worst. Even when you go to, we were lucky enough, we were good in Belfast this year, but the Belfast trip is the worst one for you.
The Belfast trip is the longest trip from Scotland in any trip. It was a 22-hour trip when you take that ferry. I think it was 21 or 22 hours. You're like, ugh.
There was one year, I'll tell this story, because there was one year I called you and I was like, I can't believe we have to arrive there. We arrived there and you put that in my mind. And I really like that idea. We're like, we arrived there 4 hours before the game. This, I think, was my first year in Dundee. Did you guys have to do the same? Well, we took the late ferry.
We started taking the late ferry and arriving like an hour and 10 minutes before the game, as opposed to 4 hours. So we're just in, gone. We didn't have to get up so early. And there was less time, because what do you do late? You know, but we did, sometimes we actually got a hotel for a couple hours for the guys. We did that. Mm-hmm. But I don't think we were winning enough to get that benefit later on. So we took the late ferry. We won. So then obviously you do it again.
Yeah.
So I think the first time we tried it, we won. and then we just kept doing it, I think. Yeah, I think we did it like two or three more times. But it was just the guys liked it better. You know, they just, they had to rush a little bit more, but they weren't laying around for 3-4 hours killing time before the game, you know, at the Odyssey. So it kind of worked out a little bit better, I think, for us. But it wouldn't be every coach's dream, I don't think. But we just felt that we were prepared. You know, we just had a meeting before we got on the ferry to elude that time that we would need at the rink, and just kind of let the guys get in, get focused, get on the ice, and then go.
We always felt, I asked my players the second year if you would want to do it. We tried it. I think we had a good game, but it was a meaningless game because it was the second leg of a Challenge Cup. And then I asked the guys, and I think it was my starting goalie, Pontus, he said, listen, Pash, I prefer arriving before and stretching and whatnot. So we went back to the old ways. But I think for us, sometimes the younger guys like to, you know, walk around in Belfast too before the game and go have a coffee. So that was a bit different for sure.
Yeah, I think the first time they go there too, it's unique for guys to go to Northern Ireland. You know, yeah. It's always kind of like, I'm not a bucket list thing, but it is something they want to look to the first time over there. You hear so much about it, especially as Canadians, right? You hear a lot about Belfast and Northern Ireland. Yeah. So, yeah, it's cool the first year they get a little bit of time to go out and explore before they can.
Both of you guys talked about the pressures of being a player coach and how you didn't like that. How difficult is it? Is it even worse when you lose one of those games, Ryan, when you're the GM and you're the coach? Does it hurt even more?
I think it's the same as if you're just a coach. I mean, your main role, obviously, is big roles, coaching during the season, you know, during those weekends. I don't think there's any more added pressure for me anyways. I don't know. I can't speak for Cash. But I think just in our situation, I think we know the league so well. Like we know the importance of dropping a game in late September, what it could mean in March, you know, and you can't exactly say that to your players because of, like, you know, what? Like, we still have 50 plus games or whatever, you know, but I think we understand the fine line between making playoffs and not making playoffs or mid-table or whatever it is so well. And like you said, we touched on it before, this league's so competitive. Like, it's so competitive. We know exactly what games will come to haunt us. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and then, you know, we're pretty realistic with our situation. But at the same time, I don't ever go into a game thinking, I don't think I can win, you know, with Manchester. Like, I don't go into any building going, oh, there's just no way we're not going to win today or we're going to win today. You know, that's where I think the parity in the league is so good and so strong.
I've never been as confident to go in any building as I did the last 2 years. And I can assume it was the same for you. It'd be the same for anybody. Like, I was as confident to go to Cardiff and Sheffield, and we've had results there, than going to any place in the league. I don't think now, as much as there's maybe some competitive imbalance with people, how they spend their money. And that's, listen, everybody can have their opinion, but for us, I know Finner is the same way. Maybe he's not, but I would assume he's the same way. I mean, Finner, we can talk throughout the week and we're playing this, but I know he thinks he can win. And, like, you know I think I could win my game against Sheffield or Nottingham or Cardiff, you know, and it's the same thing. So the parity of the league is, it's almost like, also when you get to that phase, you kind of know, like, for example, if Sheffield play Manchester, you think, oh, let's have Sheffield win because we're competing against Manchester. Mm-hmm. You know deep down that Manchester can beat Sheffield, you know, and I'm sure it's the same for all teams, you know, especially coming down to that, the last few spots at the end of the season.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's kind of a league within two leagues, you know, like you're kind of looking, when once you start breaking off, you got your top and then you got your bottom, you know, 4-8, and we're all jostling for position, and usually 8-4 is fairly tight. Mm-hmm. You know, and then 1-2-3 is very tight. So it kind of turns into two kind of leagues, and it's exciting. And then this year we're set for like a great finish. Mm-hmm. And with, you know, what is it, 2 out of 4, we're going to make playoffs.
Well, it was you and us, we were going to make it. Both teams, Manchester and Stars, we're going to make it. So who's left out then? I think it was Glasgow. Glasgow weren't going to make it.
It's the other side.
That works well. But you know what? The last 2 years, it's been so tight and it's so competitive. But I think the big difference from the top teams is, you saw that with Sheffield a few years back and the other teams, is we get into, which is unfortunate at times, but we do get into injury trouble. And that's where, for example, another team would bring in other players. But I think but this year, and same with us, I think we've built more depth as well, and that helped.
Yeah, I think we've kind of gone around the road where we're comfortable getting young Brits now.
Yeah.
You know, we understand where we're at. And I think you guys are the same, right?
Yeah.
I think you guys signed Morrissey there, which is a great signing. We got Sully. But at the same time, we got you know, we got Finley Ulrich, who I think is going to be a great player. Jacob Ludowich, who again, these are, you know, these are 18, 19 year old kids. And we think they're going to be awesome players if they continue down this path. And that's the thing. I mean, it's hard for us to keep Brits. I mean, you look at the Kieran Long situation. You know, we gave Longer a good chance, gave him, put him on a great platform, and then he's, can't blame Longer for that. Of course you want to make the most money in the shortest amount of time as possible and move on. But it's difficult for teams like us to be able to get the imports that we need and also invest large money into British players. So we have to almost kind of develop our own British players. And you guys have done that with that Ingles. Like Chris Ingles could probably walk into a lot of teams and play now. Yeah. Where 3-4 years ago or 2-3 years ago, no chance. He wouldn't even on the ice for practice probably. Mm-hmm. You know. So yeah, so I think we've adopted that. We understand that's our you know, that's what we have and that's what we have to do. You know, and then if the import level changes, then we just adapt. But I kind of like that. I kind of like having these young kids that you're responsible for their baseline progression. And you know, you always want to get them all more than you do. That's a shitty thing. You know, I always told him, I said, you'd almost be better if we were dog shit and at the bottom of the pile getting pumped because you would play all the time. Or if we were so good that we're winning 5-1, 6-1 and I can just double shift you and play you. But when we're in a one goal game 99% of the time, it's very difficult to get these kids into action. Yeah. You know, I said, in a sense, yeah, you're in the right spot, but you're in a tough spot to get minutes, yeah. You know, and no coach wants to sit and not get guys on the ice, but at the same time, you have to do what's best for the club and what's best for the game. And it's a crappy situation to be in, I think, as a coach. Your heart wants them to get out there, but your head's saying maybe just hold off, you know? You know exactly what I mean.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. I always say when injuries happen, that means opportunity. And I have to say this year, of all my years, the Brits, you know, when they had the opportunity, they really stepped up, whether it be a Craig Garrigan or Duncan Spears or, you mm-hmm. know, Chris Ingles. But, and then, you know, we saw the direct effect this year when we lost Chris Ingles. And I think Chris Ingles established himself as a top six defenseman in this league. And he can play a lot of situations. And, you know, when he was injured, then you kind of hurt and you kind of look back and you say, all right, what's the game plan when he gets injured? Which was one of my first challenges with a Brit situation when a top Brit in my team gets injured. And I guess you're right, when there's one goal situations and whatnot, you're almost afraid. But as a coach, and I know you've done that against us as well, and you know, we had Craig Garrigan on the ice against you guys in key times. You had your young kids against us, and it was a good experience for them. And look at the progression from your Brits to my Brits that they have taken over the last few years. And you know, you can tell they got better. So it's just hopefully we're all able to keep them and to keep progressing so we can put them in situation. But it's always that fine line where you're in such a tight game. The game is so important. And it's like you said, it's not like you're down 5-1 or it's not like you're up 5-1. You're always in games, yeah, regardless of where you're playing. So you have no pressure
it's a tough one. You know, you want to get these kids ice and you know, and if you don't get them out early or a lot of power play penalty kill and you know, it's tough. It's tough to find that spot. It sucks. It sucks because we're all, you know, we're all humans at the end of the day. Christ, we're not cold hearted. We don't want our kids to be sitting for that long. And you want to get them out there, but at the same time, it's a real tough spot to, you know, kid that has been on the ice for 10, 12 minutes, put them in a 2-2 game with 6-7 minutes left.
You start the period, you take a penalty, I take a penalty, you take a penalty, I take a penalty. And then you think, well, 10 minutes gone in the second period, your Brit hasn't touched the ice, you're down two. You know what I mean? It's like, it's a revolving, which I almost want my Brits to be like you know, play 5-on-5 and you get opportunities, but because there's nobody more than the Brits that we want to reward. I'm sure you've had great imports in the day, but my Brits, all I want to do is give them rewards. And to be fair, I'm so happy I can say this. They forced my hand so many times that I had to do it. And I'm sure you had the same experience. And that was, you know, the opportunity you got. So I always say to them, I didn't give you anything. You earned it. You earned it. And, and you were able to play and to.
I definitely think going in this year, I got a couple of kids that Ludovic and Ulrich would have moved up that lineup, like where they could have probably broken the top nine, you know, and competed. Both of them could have competed for that nine if the import level, you know, was where we were at, if we structured that way. So that was exciting. And I think that was always the carrot for them, is knowing, you know, chances are import level might drop and there could be good opportunity and good experience this year, you know, learn the game, learn from these guys, and then, you know, next year try to compete for that ninth spot. Yeah, so that's a bit tough, but for them, obviously, but like everybody, I think they're gonna find some spots in the EPL or wherever they can in Britain if it's going, or wherever hockey's going. Hopefully they can get some spots and get ice time, because it's tough for us. You imagine those kids at that age just breaking into pro and miss a whole season. It's not a lot of fun to think about.
No, it's not. It's an adjustment for everybody.
Yeah, that's what I mean. I mean, next year, like, I'm not going to care if a kid didn't play hockey last year. I'm still going to recruit him. You know, yeah. I'm definitely not going to recruit on who played where and what last season. It's going to be one of those seasons where pick it up where we try to, you know, pick up the pieces where we can, and, you know, come November, it'll all be the same, or even mid-October next year, hopefully, if we get back up.
I mean, fairly, you look at it like this. I mean, the NHL, there's six teams that weren't in the bubble, right? And obviously, there's some teams that lost in the first round. They stopped playing at the same time as us, you know? So there's six teams plus maybe two or three that were knocked out pretty early in the playoffs, and they haven't played. And, you know, if the NHL starts in January, which they say they'll start. So I don't think the hockey is certainly something I don't think you worry. Well, maybe you do, but the way you've talked to me, you don't seem to worry that much. I don't worry about it because I do think the league will be extremely competitive when it gets back, because these guys will have trained and will be ready. It's just like one of those, I guess, a season that you didn't get much ice time or something like that, you know?
Yeah, I agree. I don't think we're going to see. I think once hopefully August comes and we all get back to training camp and playing games, it'll just pick up where we left off. I like, people always talk about concern about fans. I'm not concerned about the fans, because I think, you know, this isn't a case where a team went bankrupt and owed everybody money and then reformed under a new name three, four, you know, like wiped out our full season and a half, you know? So I think the fans will come and support us. I don't think they're going to walk away from this game. You know, obviously casual fans, you got to work to get them through the door anyways. But I still think the passion will be there, if not more. You know, you take something away that somebody wants, they want it more. And I hope I'm right. You know, I do hope I'm right. I hope everybody's attendance is bumped and we can just pick up and get going again.
I think it's a huge opportunity for the league to come out stronger than ever, too, whether it be on the ice or off the ice. I think if we all work together, the 10 teams to – you know, like, you guys do a lot of work in the background. We do a lot of work. You look at a team like Sheffield. So I'm assuming the 10 teams are actually, if they're not, well, in my opinion, they should be doing a bit of things to keep the buzz going and keep their fans interested. Because once this starts, I think there's a great opportunity to, you know, start fresh and, like, put teams all in good positions to, you know, start maybe an Elite League 2.0, you know, and you get back to to maybe better things, and hopefully the league does that point as well.
I think, like, from a business standpoint, when you look back, I think in years down the road, and we'll look back at the unique ways we stayed relevant, and, you know, and because usually, you know, and we're guilty of it, and I'm sure you guys are, and everybody is. At the end of the year, you kind of go dark. You kind of sell off what you got, and then you go dark. Where this year, through the lockdown, we found ways to stay relevant, make some money, whether it's through online raffles, draws, games of the week, you name it, you know, and that's something I think we're all going to continue doing, because why wouldn't, you know, the fans are still there, they're still engaged. And I think, so looking back, we, you know, take some positives from a business standpoint, hey, we found a way to kind of stay somewhat relevant during the summer months, which is something that maybe we took for granted for, never tried, you know, because maybe we didn't have to or not. So you know, like we said, we're going to continue doing that. So we're a year-round sport. We're a year-round club. We're a year-round voice, and you know, hope that our fans will continue to support that even after a long season. So I think, you know, that is a positive and a unique positive to this horrible situation, is that we have, you know, found new ways to create income for a club. And like you said, clubs like ours never create enough income. They're, you know, we're always fighting for every penny to put the best product on the ice. So we don't feel guilty about doing what we do because we have to do it. Yeah. You know, we're not blessed with 8,000 stadiums and, you know, 3,000 season ticket holders. So we have to find ways to stay relevant and, you know, and find ways that are affordable for our fan base to want to enjoy it and be able to contribute.
I think if anything, it's how this business has been since the last few years, at least in my experience in this league, how, you know, this league, whether I was, you know, working in previous teams to now, it's really full blown 365 days a week, 7 days a week. And even in the worst pandemic history, we're all doing, you know, little things and, you know, to get better as a club, but also keep going through hard times.
Yeah, and I think the big difference between us and football, and you know, and it, I think it goes all the way to Cardiff, speaking to Killer, is we actually give a shit about how much stuff costs. Yeah. You know, because none of us are rich, none of us are billionaires. You know, we're all normal Joe Blows. We're all middle class people. And you know, so we don't sit there and go, hey, do you think you can get 80, 90 quid for this? You're like, well, what's affordable for today? You know, what is affordable for our fans? And that is at the forefront of our, of what we, how we think and when we do business. We're thinking, well, what is affordable? Because we don't want to put something that gets the top 1% involved. Yeah. You know, and yeah. I think, and especially now, you know, that's why these raffles are so good. It's a pound or 2 pounds, you know. If you want to get involved, great. If you don't, no problem. It's okay. You know, I think those are great. You know, I think, and then if you're, you know, jerseys and stuff, you want to get them out the door at an affordable price so people can get something that they have, that they want, but at the same time, they get a good deal on it because, well, we are in a pandemic. And I think that's a big difference in ice hockey that nobody really talks about, is that the ownership are normal people. You know, like they're not flying in on their jet, you know, in their jet to come watch a game, then flying off to London. You know, like they're fairly normal people that run and operate clubs out of passion, and not always, you know, there's obviously the business has to make money to continue, you know, but nobody nobody's jetting off to the Bahamas at, you know, off the back of a successful season, you know, financially. But so I think that's unique in a way that the people behind the scenes are normal people. And, you know, of course it's easy to hate on them. And, you know, like the Ward guys are awesome. Like your owners are good dudes. They're just good people. Chris, I see them every game. You know, they're there at the gate. They're welcoming the fans in. Like, you just don't get that. And we're at a high level and you still get that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? The EIHL is a legit level, but you still have fans welcoming in. You still have, you know, modern day ownership of normal guys running in that are at every game, that are a part of the community. And I think that's kind of unique and something that, I think is maybe overlooked from a lot of our fan base, because they cross over from football and they have the same passion. What's that?
How easy the players are accessible as well.
Yeah. You know? We don't take ourselves too seriously in this game, and I think some guys are surprised just how popular they are, because they don't think of themselves that way. Mm-hmm. You know, I think I never did anyways.
Yeah.
I'd talk to anybody. I don't care. You know. Yeah. Well,
you're gonna realize how popular you are, Finner, with this video that Stars TV guys prepared. So you want to show him what you guys prepared for Finner?
Oh Jesus!
Let's put this on some of your highlights and Finner's Dundee Ice Arena over the years.
Am I picking my nose?
That was worse.
That one. That was an icing. I didn't like the icing there. Same Stanley fourth there. Yeah.
Danny, remember you made a video in the video you said, Danny, it's 5 foot offside.
Yep.
You remember that video?
Brilliant, Regent. Much yep. The Dundee Stars delight.
My first year.
Yeah. Oh, finally, he's got a stick and he's bashing the box. Amazing.
Probably running the clock down again.
Yeah. Well, he's got the referee's attention, which is what he's going to do.
This is one way action when he comes over, though. Suit looks good, though.
Yeah. I don't think you need to get to the linesman now, do you?
It's a fashion show, too. You got to make sure you're well dressed because if there's any break in the action, they usually chirp your style.
Yeah, they'll zoom on you. Stars TV used to zoom on me when I ripped my trousers one time.
I said, Mark, where did you get that impressive pocket square from?
As the coach says,
I was hoping he'd leave his suits here when I first arrived, but they wouldn't have fit anyways.
He had those alligator shoes on all the time.
I bet he's got something to do with life, currently, though.
Mikey Mo.
Mikey Mo. Look at Mikey.
Get your sticks measured, guys. Get the gloves tight.
If anybody knows,
like, okay, now I get the jokes.
One of the best guys in hockey, Mike Morin.
Yeah. Ryan finally knows the score.
It would be nice to win a game so I don't always look so pissed off there.
They're probably talking up in his face.
Oh, this conversation. What's this conversation like?
Toby says, I'll put a powder on the top.
And Ryan said, I'll just get this from Paul Fraser then.
You're wrong.
You could take that. Oh, he means business. Don't know what he's saying. Are we giving Omar Pasha the evil eyes there? I don't know. Let's see.
Just checking out your suit. What's that, a three piece?
It's a bit tight there.
Got that from. Looking nice, relaxed on the storm bench.
Yeah.
You know what they look like? A couple of detective sergeants. Wow. I mean,
Stars TV are behind the scenes. They're not behind the scenes. Behind the screen, they're good, eh? They're good at chirping.
They chirp you all day long. That's why it's not good to have breaks as an opposing coach because you know the camera's on you and they're just talking about you.
Right at the end of the second period. Well, it's pretty obvious we're not going to get a power play here. Like,
Omar Pasha, no happy man this time.
Yeah, there's no infinity, but no one's happy.
It's always a good sign when both coaches are yelling at the refs.
I think we wind each other up, dude. We're like, I want to yell at him. No, you want to yell at him. Poor Wardy.
Oh.
The best coach's exit here ever.
This one a bit incognito.
I can't believe nobody's fallen. Did I finger him?
Yeah.
I think I did it. I did. Yeah. I remember like, oh, I hope they're not on me on that one.
But you know what, Peter? Who's your favorite coach to interview, guys? Stars TV. They always say that.
Yeah, it's all. Yeah.
They love interviewing you. And they always say, old dog has the utmost respect for you, Finner. I can tell
we
you.
We always have good interviews. I never freaking win there, though. That's a problem. Yeah. I always say, Pash, listen, let me get to overtime. I'll let you get to overtime.
I think our record last 2 years were both win at home and lose away.
Yeah, I think we're identical. Yeah. I mean, if you took it over the last 3 years, I would say I would be surprised. I'd be surprised if it was more than 2 points between us.
I never won, man. I think
won once in Dundee.
I think it's just because I don't know. It's a weird one. We always play hard against each. I think they're always good. They're always tight games. There's never
always tight.
I think in the last 2 years, especially like, you know, with Ginner and, you know, with Pontus and LeClaire, it was always good battles with goalies as well. And, it's tight everywhere. You know, you always also have you know, matchups where, you know, when you have your, like we were talking about coaching earlier, you play against that 1-4 system, it's really tough to break down. And yeah, it's always tough challenges, but it's, that's like you said about the league itself. You want to take any questions, Swanee?
Yeah, we'll squeeze in some questions before we wrap up tonight's show. The first one from John O'Neill. Question for Swanee. Do you really like Cliff Richard? Sorry, I posted up a Cliff Richard vinyl the other day, Omar. That's a slight point. It was his 80th birthday.
I don't know who that is.
So, yeah, I'm not answering that, John. Editor Eddie. Hi there, sir. I'm not sure if this is ice hockey only chat, but I will ask anyway. I'm a football fan and want to know the lads' predictions for the big game tomorrow. Celtic or Rangers? Please answer.
I think Finner, you're not in Glasgow.
I signed a contract that I would never discuss.
And she talked.
I signed an NDA that I would never discuss Celtic or Ranger business.
You have a lifelong contract when you sign with the Glasgow Clan.
Yeah, you can't support one or the other.
Well, I was just amazed that did it work now? Did Nicola force Sky to watch to make the game free now?
I think she was, but I don't know if it happened.
I don't know. I want to watch some good football, so I'll probably watch Dundee United, I guess. No, I'm just kidding, Rangers fans or Celtic fan.
I can't believe we're not making
a good football game will be good.
Just make a prediction, Pash. Come on. You're in Dundee anyway.
I can probably make a prediction. I don't know. Our main sponsor, James Kitmark, he's a big Celtic fan. Elliot's a big Rangers fan because now he's working for the club. So let's go with a market here. It's going to be a 1-1 draw.
That's what I was going to go with. 2-2.
1-1 draw tomorrow.
I got 2-2.
2-2.
Celtic win for me, guys. I'm going to be brave and say the honest answer.
I got under 4.5.
What's Ryan's least favorite rink? Well, there you go.
I would say Guildford.
Yeah.
Guildford for me. I'm going Guildford.
Guildford. Oh, here we are. Lightning Jack. Pash, are you going to bring that Starsky down on the bus? He keeps texting me saying he wants to fight.
Lightning Jack. I remember John Hammond screaming, Lightning Jack. I don't know Lightning. I think Starsky's a lovable, like, for kids. I don't think he's a fighting guy. We're more centered. Our mascot, we changed. I think the lawman would beat anybody up. We used to have the lawman, but he would scare kids.
Scott Pitt, yeah.
I guess so. Scott Pitt, so yeah. There you go, Finner, your scores.
Scores to wrap up the show, Finners. Look, there you go.
Oh, geez.
2-2, that's all right.
Tight one.
But Finner, listen, thanks for coming on because it's already been an hour and a half. Time flew by. But thanks again for coming for on a Friday night. Obviously.
Where else are we going to go? The pub's shut down anyways. We're in tier 3 lockdown here.
But thanks a lot, Finner. And obviously, you've been in the league for a while. I've been following you for all this time, too, when I entered the league. So it's good that.
Yeah. Thanks for having me, guys. Honestly, pleasure. Awesome. And hope to see you guys soon.
Yeah.
One of those great interviews after a big win.
More controversy, please, at the end of the periods.
The only way we'll lose is if the refs screw us.
Only way we'll lose if the video camera doesn't get it right.
Your own video camera. Yeah, I think that might be the only game I've won.
But Stars TV has the now, if any time we get screwed, Swanee has to run with the laptop to the score judge. So that's his new motto.
We're doing the same as you, Ryan. Win at all costs.
We always discuss, Ryan. We said, let's always have 3-point games. So it always has to finish in overtime.
Exactly. That's the dream right there.
Thanks a lot for coming on tonight. I appreciate it.
Awesome. You guys. Thanks a lot, eh? Thanks for having me.
Well, Omar, what a great show. Really good to listen to you guys. They're bouncing ideas off each other in both similar roles, you know, so it's quite an interesting insight. Bad news for Dundee, though, Omar. They're 3-1 down. They were 2-0 down. Charlie Adams scored a goal to bring it back to 2-1, and then Hearts got a penalty. So we're just approaching half-time, and it's 3-1 Hearts. So nightmare for that, for any Dundee fans watching. But hopefully better in the second half. Yeah. Anyway, just to remind everybody, Omar, the beautiful towels will be in the shop. Are they in the store now, or are they going to be there?
Yeah, they are. She put some products out. Well, James or Elizabeth from Kipmer put them out, I think, last night. So, no, the shop's been going well. Obviously, goal member, we'll have some cool events coming up. Like we said, we always want to keep active, and we want to keep it going. We had a great guest tonight in Ryan. I think he's doing, you know, he did a great job there in Manch and trying to get those fans involved. Us, we're trying to do the same here. So hopefully we'll get more news in the next coming weeks of the progression, and hopefully we'll have some good news. But now that everybody's in, I guess, mini lockdown, however you want to call it, more time for viewers to watch Stars TV and you, Swanee.
Yeah,
they want to watch you. They're coming for you. That's who they want to watch.
I'm absolutely devastated. 4-1 Hearts are now, Omar. This is
it. 4-1 now.
4-1 now, just before halftime on the 46th minute.
We were gonna take the credit if James McPake would have won that game. It was because he came on this show. I don't know.
I think
come back now.
I don't think we'll get him back on in a long time. you never know. But anyway. Omar, thanks very much. Everybody remember to keep an eye on all our social media pages. Sign up for the Gold Club if you haven't done so already and want to. Great prize there with it. It's not a hospitality box. You're getting tickets. Let's clarify that. Unless Ryan Finnerty is picking up the tab for that himself. He is quite a generous man. So tweet him, ask if he'll upgrade you. I don't know. But
he usually has a busy box at the Final Four. So I don't know if he'll have room and. So yeah, tickets in a good spot. Put them in the Dundee Stars section, you know. So it'll be good.
Exactly, but yeah, no, that's the 30th of October for signups for that. Keep an eye on the social media and all the 50-50 stuff and shirt off the back and so on. And again, everyone at the Dundee Stars appreciates your support in any way you can.
Thanks a lot, guys, for tuning in again this week. It was good fun, and we'll see you next weekend.
Yeah,
next Friday. All right, take care.